Good evening, everybody. The next lecture is on gastroesophageal reflux disease, ISPACON guidelines 2021 by Dr. Neela Mohan. Dr. Neela Mohan is currently the director of pediatrics and head of the Department of Pediatric Gastroenterology, Hepatology, and Liver Transplantation, Medanta Med City, New Delhi. She has received Dr. B.C. Roy National Award and Distinguished National Board Examinations Teacher Award. And currently, she is also the president of Commonwealth Association of Pediatrics Gastroenterology and Nutrition, and she has many papers to accredit. And we are privileged to have Dr. Neela Mohan as the president-elect of ISPACON for next 2 years. Dr. Neela Mohan, please.
Thanks, Sumati. And it's been a wonderful day yesterday with all those enlightenment room experts, and would like to thank the organizers for this opportunity. And my title is the GRD, ISPACON Guidelines 2021, and I speak on behalf of my team, that is John Mathai, Rishi, Jaya, Rimjim, Vibhor. So we came with these guidelines by the Indian Society of Pediatric Gastroenterology, Hepatology, Nutrition in this year, which is on diagnosis and management of gastroesophageal reflux in children. Basically, a group of experts were shortlisted for this consensus. Several online meetings were held from mid-October to December. A consensus was reached on most aspects, and a writing committee was constituted of different parts, and the statement was sent to the entire group for approval. And I would like to say probably this is one of the few consensus, because it was online, we were able to finish it within 3 months. Everything, as you can see, had gone for printing. So the definitions of gastroesophageal reflux, it's physiological, involuntary passage of gastric contents into the esophagus with or without visible regurgitation. So what's regurgitation? It's bringing up of the gastric contents into the oral cavity and sometimes out of the mouth. But remember, in the absence of regurgitation also, you could have reflux. Vomiting. Forceful expulsion of the gastric contents through the mouth, which involves the intense muscular activity of the respiratory and abdominal muscles and is essentially triggered. Somatic reflex sometimes triggered by reflux. So gastroesophageal reflux disease is a pathological form of GER, which results in symptoms that affect daily activities or complications that cause systemic disease. This is just focusing on the diagnosis and management, so we will not discuss epidemiology, etc. What are the typical clinical features of GRD? Let's divide them into infants and older children and adolescents. Infants do not behave like adults. Their symptoms are predominantly regurgitation, vomiting, irritable during and after feeding, refusal to feed, failure to thrive, inconsolable crying. As compared to children, there the typical symptoms would be nausea, vomiting, epigastric pain, heartburn, chest burn. Now this is called as the typical symptoms which you would have, and which is seen close to around 60% of the children. The other manifestations could include the water thrush, where you get, you know, bitter, sour taste in the mouth, spitting, drooling, choking during feeds and at night, or poor appetite and refusal to feed in younger children too, could be a part of reflux disease. What are the atypical manifestations? When I mean atypical, I mean not the typical esophageal symptoms that we talk about. So here we are focusing on the respiratory part, which is apnea, stridor, wheezing, hematemesis, anemia, neurobehavioral changes, Sandivers syndrome. We all know Sandivers is arching of the neck and the body, which is seen done by an infant to trying to extend and prevent these symptoms. And similarly, in an older child, respiratory symptoms, I mean something like recurrent pneumonia, cough, strike, bronchospasm, laryngitis, hoarseness of voice, sinusitis, otitis media, dental erosions, anemia, GI bleeding, halitosis, very important when they get up in the morning, parents say that, you know, the child has a bad smell in the mouth. So that's also typically because of the acid that comes up. And of course, sleep disturbances could be a part of reflux disease in children and adolescents. So as I mentioned to you, 60% have those typical, you know, epigastric pain, regurgitation, and extraesophageal, but nausea and vomiting are seen in 20% of the children. But mind you, when I talk about infants, the classical and the younger children, the classical reflux syndrome, the chest pain and all that we talk about, they may not be able to describe it. And it will be just a handful of 6 to 8% in the studies shown that they talk about it in less than 8 years. Now, what are the risk factors for infants? Prematurity, apnea medications, anomalies of respiratory tract, post-operative atresia, diaphragmatic hernia, neurological impairment, abdominal defects like gastroschisis, omphalocele, or NG tube placement itself can be a risk factor for reflux, which you actually end up thinking that you're giving it for treatment too. So these are the risk factors in infants as compared to children. The risk factors is predominantly obesity. We all know that the issues that come up with the diaphragm in obesity and the chronic respiratory diseases, patients who are asthmatic or non, those medications. Having said that, there was a recent meta-analysis which spoke that there was no definite correlation by giving treatment of PPI along with the standard care in preventing such attacks in children. But there are a lot of studies which do talk about asthma as a risk factor. So neurological impairment, hiatus hernia injury, and the post-ecclesia treatment of patients who've undergone surgery, you know, the TOF atresia surgeries, those, and it is predominantly the bad diet in the adolescents and children that we talk about, the sugary drinks, the soda, the fatty food, which all can be a very important cause of triggering reflux in children. How do you diagnose? Do I always need to investigate? No. Because I mentioned to you, it is physiological and you may not need test for documentation. But of course, when I said there's GRD, which is symptomatic with, you know, interfering in their activities or complications, then sometimes mostly a good history and an examination is reliable in 2/3 of the cases. But in 1/3 of the cases, you might end up with investigations. And especially in infants, when there are extraesophageal symptoms, you've got to be very sure because there's no role of an empirical treatment in infants. So we do require investigation in a subset of patients. And I'll talk about what these investigations could be. People talk about this Orenstein-Stroll and the other infant GR questionnaire. Is there any role? Well, to cut the long story short, in a place like India, where we are predominantly breastfeeding and not so much of bottle feeding, we find it difficult to recommend this, you know, based on this 12 items to recommend it in the Indian population. So we really are not very popular with this questionnaire. But what are the red flag signs where you will think of a differential diagnosis? Let's take the infants and then the children. So in infants, especially if you get it in the first week, you can't just start thinking of reflux. You have to think of other conditions like NEC or congenital anomalies, pyloric stenosis, intestinal obstructions, malrotations, etc. Then if there is associated microcephaly, macrocephaly, genetic and metabolic syndromes. So keep in mind of alternatives beside reflux in infants, especially in this. Besides this, the there would be, you know, I had a child recently when we were we thought it was reflux, and then eventually when we saw the videos of choking, and the mother was used to say that she literally needs to push the feed down, and we realized that there was palatopharyngeal incompetence. So do remember, it's not always reflux. Conditions like this where you have poor palatopharyngeal incontinence, etc., can be the cause. And of course, when there is fever, urinary sepsis, hash browns, constipation, distension, all this, you must keep in mind to rule out the other organic causes, and that's why I call them red flag signs. Similarly, in children, the red flag signs is pain, bleeding, cyclic symptoms, and Munchausen syndrome should be kept in mind. Rumination, where there is a lot of vomiting, 8 to 10, just immediately after a feed, they get the food in the mouth and then they swallow it or they spit it. So these also you need to keep in mind about other conditions like rumination, which are of course diagnosed either by good clinical history or by esophageal manometry. And then what are the other investigations besides the history, the charts that I talked about? So we'll just go through it quickly. One is the upper GI endoscopy, the multi-impedance, which we call the multi-channel intraluminal pH impedance pH metry, the trial of PPI therapy, esophageal manometry, technetium scan, milk scan, or the scintigraphy, and barium series or upper contrast studies. Quickly, the role of them. Upper GI helps visualization of the mucosa. You can just see the mucosa lesions, what is the lower esophageal sphincter, and obtain biopsies to rule out conditions like milk allergy, esophageal esophagitis. And in the right side picture, you can see achalasia, where you know there was a pinhole esophagus that you can identify through this. And of course, hiatus hernia, where the pinch and the G junction, they are, you know, away from each other, so you can identify endoscopically. Besides that, on the left side, I've shown you some ridging and white specks, which is usually typically seen in esophageal esophagitis. And on the right side, you have lesions, esophagitis, which is reflux disease. And for the young students, would like to remind that we have this various classification so that there's uniformity in people who describe it, whether it is small lesions, A, B, C, D. So basically trying to describe the extent of the disease, and you can see it through the biopsy, even if you're not able to see, which is non-erosive reflux disease, NERD, where biopsies may be very useful to rule out other conditions like esophageal allergies and to rule out a reflux disease like basal zone hyperplasia and elongation of the retapex. So when do you ask for an endoscopy? This is an important slide which you need to go through slowly. Any child with hematemesis, difficulty in swallowing dysphagia, food aversion history, persistent growth faltering, Sandifer's syndrome, persistent retrosternal or epigastric pain in older children, despite a trial of PPI. We don't give a trial in infants, but in older we do. So despite that, unexplained anemia, referral for surgery, that is fundoplication. Before that, please ensure your upper GI endoscopy or even impedance, pH metry and manometry sometimes are done before you subject a patient for surgery. And very few patients that you end up with surgery. So what is 24-hour pH monitoring? Wherein you just put in a probe into the esophagus and you monitor, which is normally the pH is an alkaline. You see how many, what is the percentage, which is less than 4. So you look at the number of reflux episodes, how long do they last, what is the longest reflux, how many are more than 5 minutes, what is the percentage of the total in 24 hours that the pH was there. So was it more than 10% in infants is abnormal and 7% in that. Having said that, small children in milk, you can have alkaline reflux, not necessarily acidic. So the sensitivity is very poor, 40 to 80%, but it is good for correlating symptoms. You have cough, you have some symptoms, and at that time, how was it? So we moved now from 24 hour to impedance. What is this? Anything, any activity, electrical impedance activity, which is a solid, liquid, or air, when it passes across the sensors or the catheters, we place it in the esophagus, it measures. So it is useful because it can tell you an acid reflux, which is less than 4 to 7 weak acidic or more than 7 alkaline. And we know that infants can have 50% of them will be missed if we just look only for acid. So impedance pH metric is what the catheters are available. Those catheters are all almost been dusted now. And it is very useful to correlate symptoms with reflux. But the drawbacks is it's a 24-hour. You need to put the probe and send the patient, small toddlers, they may pull it off. You need to be, so you limit these conditions, and I'll discuss in the next slide when, what are the patterns you see? Three patterns we talk about. Functional heartburn, which means when you do impedance, there is a normal acid exposure and no symptom, but you get this functional dyspepsia symptoms. Second is non-erosive reflux. Endoscopically, you could not see erosions, but you did find abnormal acid exposure. Esophageal hypersensitivity. Though the exposure was normal, but there was a definite correlation with the symptoms. So there were those hypersensitivity esophagus we call. So this, how do you identify? You just can't do it without the esophageal impedance pH metric. And I've been talking about these lectures for 1.5 decades, and I'm so glad that the consensus after nearly more than a decade talks about the role of this. And we have advanced in India into areas. So there are centers where you can go. So this is the issue with it, that it's high cost, non-available, paucity of reference value in children and there. But the indications are infants with extra esophageal symptoms like apnea, events, non-epileptic seizures, feed refusal with failure to thrive in the absence of other diagnosis, unconsolable crying and you're not really sure what's going on, and follow-up of conditions like atresia, diaphragmatic, to assess efficacy of therapy where despite some, you know, the symptoms are persisting, so we only want you to know. And of course, in adolescence, when you think you get those non-typical symptoms and you're not sure about the clinical picture and you think it is a reflux disease, then you need this impedance to confirm the diagnosis. So trial of PPI, I've also mentioned that it is sometimes given for 2 to 4 weeks in older children, but it has no role in infants. Manometry is poor, specificity and sensitivity is basically done for ruling out motility disorders, and therefore prior to surgery, application, that's when we do offer diagnosis of achalasia, as I mentioned. You can also ask for a baby for achalasia endoscopy, but the classical diagnosis is by a manometry. If you want to subject for any surgery, then you need to do the diagnosis. The milk sand sensitivity is tossing a coin in the air. If it picks up, it's fine, but if it misses, it may still be there. The contrast studies are not meant for diagnosis of reflux. They are basically meant for ruling out anatomic abnormalities. Management, we know that H2 receptors, usually ranitidine is that which act, and PPI therapy is more efficacious because it acts on both gastrin and at the output it's acting. So they are the anchor for medical treatment for GRD. You need to give them 0.5 to 1 hour before, but a large RCT with poorly controlled asthma did not show improvement in. Don't forget that long-term therapy does have side effects, GI, respiratory, renal issues, metabolic, calcium, etc. So these are the PPI which are available in India. Now we do have esomeprazole, which is allowed even in less than 1 year, infants in less than 1 year. Ranitidine is safe, effective, administered really, but it suppresses 70% because it's act on H2. One of the drawbacks is tachyphylaxis. Advantage is it is only mild and moderate. The doses I've given there, it is approved in newborns and infants. There was an issue about NDMA, contamination and this with ranitidine, and there were concerns about its carcinogenesis. But there is some news now that this article, which was in this paper, was withdrawn by the authors. They were retracted the oral intake of this thing. And even there are articles which have come out, like from Korea's this study, that there's no evidence of NDMA contamination. Similarly, Solar is the API, which is manufacturing in India. They've talked about the quality, and the European group have talked about the quality. So a lot of work has happened in the last 2 years about our concerns of NDMA, and we're quite comfortable now. Those concerns are no more as we thought it to be. It would take ages and ages for anybody to get that. No definite role of prokinetics, baclofen, antacid surface agents, and I wouldn't talk much. Refractive is unresponsive to 8 weeks of optimal therapy and refer to an expert. We need to do things. Surgical treatment, only an expert needs to decide. So please refer to an expert who will decide. So to sum up, my dear colleagues, I will talk about the chart till now, what I've talked, that in infants with suspected GR or GRD, a good history examination and a growth is very important. Look for the risk factors, look for the red flag signs to rule out reflux and all. If there is no red flag signs to think of any other alternative and you think of reflux, then reassurance feed thickness, avoid overfeeding. 4 weeks, see how it goes. Symptom improvement, weight gain, good, follow up. No improvement after 4 weeks, I would suggest, rather, the guidelines suggest, refer to a pediatric gastroenterologist. We reassess for non-GI causes. If we find the other non-GI causes, like eosinophilic esophagitis, eclampsia, whatever I've been talking about, then you give appropriate therapy for that. If we don't find the other GI causes and we think, yes, it is more suspicion of milk allergy, then we manage a CMPA. There is over-ambitious use and diagnosis of CMPA now in India. Earlier, there was under and over. So we need to understand and take things with a pinch of salt. Refractive respiratory symptoms to look for aspiration, milksan or technetium is good. Symptoms which are predominantly extraesophageal manifestation infants, we think about the pH and the impedance study. And I've already talked in detail about its indication. I've already talked in details about indications for endoscopy like hematemesis, dysphagia, feeding aversion, faltering, backhacking, retrosternal or epigastric pain, and explain iron deficiency anemia or before subjecting for surgery like fundoplication. So that is where we talk. Coming to last slide, which is suspected in a child. If you have typical symptoms, yes, we give a trial of PPI therapy. If it improves, fine. We stop after 2 weeks therapy. If it recurs, please refer for an endoscopy. In endoscopy or in atypical symptoms also, we go in for endoscopy. We look for erosive esophagitis, then we give a longer duration of therapy, eosinophilic esophagitis specific therapy. And if we still find the no non-endoscopic reflux disease and we are suspecting reflux disease, then we go for impedance metry to confirm, because all cases cannot be diagnosed by endoscopy. So my dear colleague, GR is physiological. Investigations are required only when we think it's pathological. Esophagitis is the commonest manifestation in older children. And endoscopy is those with esophageal manifestation, dysphagia, emetosis, and pH monitorings continue only with extraesophageal symptoms. Barium is only for anatomical abnormalities. Empirical therapy is for older children and not infants. Refractive, not responsive to 3 months, refer to an expert for decision of further management and surgery. This is an age-related phenomena which usually improves with age or older children because of obesity and diet and lifestyle issues. It's a clinical diagnosis. 1/3 of them may require investigations like endoscopy, impedance, pH metry. In a very select patients, PPI are the mainstay of therapy. Empirical therapy has no benefit in infants, and that's when we suggest that you need to diagnose. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Neelam, for an excellent presentation.